So we are here in Jardín Botánico of Bogotá with Professor Shmalev, which is and one of the most important experts in the world of ecological economics. He's here for the Cátedra Homero Cuevas, which is a very important event in our university. So welcome, first of all.
Thank you.
I think, honestly, that most of the people really doesn't know what ecological economics is. So let's start from the beginning. So can you give it as a definition about ecological economics?
Well, ecological economics started probably in the end of 1980s as an interdisciplinary field initiated by a group of scientists from different disciplines. So there were economists, there were physicists, and they were very much dissatisfied with the way the environmental issues have been dealt with in the past, and they decided that there is a need for a more systemic approach dealing with economy-environment interactions. So there are many alternative definitions, but one of the most lucid and simple ones is that ecological economics addresses system economy interactions in the broadest sense.
Okay, so let me help you like clarifying a little bit more for people that isn't like literate on this topic. So in the past, let's say in mainstream economics, usually environmental issue have been treated like a problem of externality, let's say, a social cost induced by production or consumption, for example. So this is what can be called like environmental economics, maybe. So is this part of ecological economics or not? And in what sense you distance yourself from standard environmental economics?
Well, I would say that environmental economics and ecological economics have a lot of overlap, but they're still seen as slightly different schools, and mostly for methodological reasons. I guess a lot of ecological economists are very happy and supportive of the contributions that environmental economists did in the previous years, especially on the front of Pigouvian taxation and, you know, all forms of resource and environmental taxes, which are now being applied in the EU, for example. But on the other hand, there is a lot of new approaches which ecological economists brought, which among others include the decision-making tools based on the application of multi-criteria methods, which is really the next step from the cost-benefit analysis, which is essentially a partial case of a multi-criteria decision aid. Ecological economists have been dealing a lot with alternative ways of measuring progress, you know, since the time of Herman Daly, who proposed the Index of Sustainable Economic Welfare and so on. And, you know, my work included some multidimensional measures of progress for countries also. So there's, at the same time, you know, there is a lot of other more subtle differences. And I would say it's an ongoing debate. It's very useful for a discipline as such, because there's a dialogue, there is tension. As always, you know, the truth emerges when there is a very intense argument.
And I mean, you said that ecological economics started in the 1980s. Are there kind of traditional or classical economics that somehow you consider as father of? Because if we go back in the history of economic thoughts, of course, we have some scholars that started like pointing out that there may be limits to growth, for example, or others that somehow introduce the problem of economics and the economy as included in a more general like biosphere or approach, like Jorge Skurrögen, for example. So
yes. Well, I guess everybody has his own or her own history of ecological economics. So when I give this course, I offer students a portrait gallery of the people who, from my point of view, made the most fundamental contribution to this interdisciplinary field, starting from quite a long way back. And in my course, I mentioned such people as Vernadsky, who worked in St. Petersburg and was the author of the concept of the global biogeochemical cycles. I mention people like Danella and Dennis Meadows' Limits to Growth work of 1972, E.F. Schumacher, Herman Daly, a whole range of ecological economists from many different countries who worked on institutional issues, as Peter Söderbaum or Harald Vatten, or Robert Ayres, who was really a true pioneer paper in 1968. And essentially, he was the one who introduced material flows analysis, life cycle analysis, the importance of principles of physics in economics, and a whole range of these topics. So it's a very diverse pool. And coming to the issue of works of economists of the past, one of my colleagues has written a paper which is included in the edited volume that we published in 2012 called Sustainability Analysis, an Interdisciplinary Approach. It was the Palgrave book, and there is a discussion on the writings of classical economists that included important sustainability ideas which somehow were overlooked by the mainstream over the years. So people like Alfred Marshall and John Stuart Mill and Malthus have looked at these issues, and they have explored some of these aspects, and you could find quotes which show that there was some concern about availability of resources, about the long-term trends, about all these issues, but somehow they have not become part of the mainstream.
I'm curious about the following thing. You wrote papers using input-output analysis from an environmental point of view. You mentioned the issue of measurement of progress, like alternative to GDP and so on. But also you mentioned things like introducing more physics-related type of analysis and so on. So do you think that ecological economics is a sort of paradigm shift inside economics, or you think it's like more as a school of thought that can dialogue with standard or mainstream economics or existing school of thoughts in economics?
Well, I'll be frank, we have always been hoping that it is going to be a paradigm shift. Mm-hmm. It's been tremendously difficult to break through in mainstream economics departments for various reasons, for the reasons of preferences towards different journals. Ecological Economics, the journal which was started in 1989, now has a very substantial impact factor, and it's very popular due to the very topical nature of these issues. But somehow, I would say still, some traditional economic departments do not really seriously look into this. So, there is a problem of sorts, but we're trying to overcome it. Actually, if you look at the state of affairs as we speak, last year, the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere reached a very, very high level of 400 ppm. That's not been observed for at least 600,000 or even 800,000 years before. We also have observed a substantial reduction in biodiversity. According to the WWF report, in the past 40 years, we've lost about 52% of all biodiversity that we had. Plus, there is a whole range of additional issues to do with the water, plastics, which is deposited in the global ecosystems, including the oceans. And, these issues are, becoming much more discussed now with people from outside economics, people like, the top actors, like some of the British actors who have recently produced a documentary called Trashed about waste and how it's managed around the world and what happens and how it goes into the food chain and how various pollutants are accumulated in the bodies of Arctic dogs and so on. But actually, we knew about this because the whole beginning of the environmental movement in the 1960s is usually associated with a book by Rachel Carson, which is called The Silent Spring, about the use of pesticides in agriculture. And there was an example of the fact that, these chemical elements get through the food chain, get into the body of penguins. So in the early 60s, these things were already known. And I'm really surprised that, you know, so little has changed in the core of economic science. There are some, you know, add-ons, but I don't think it's sufficient.
Well, I'm curious also about this thing, because I mean, if you think at the what has been produced from physics and you know, an expert from the hard science related with, for example, anthropic related global warming, I think that this is more or less the mainstream, at least in hard science. Of course, there are a lot of resistances that are also policy related or related with interest. I mean, recently in the US, they pretended to declare that there was no anthropic global warming through the parliament as something that the policy can decide and not science. But, well, in the difficult that you perceive in being received by the economics or the mainstream economics, you think it's just a matter of the dynamics of knowledge or resistant to change or somehow, you know, corporative protection, or you think there is something more like, you know, in the way you tend to think at the economics issue, or rather, you know, a matter of interest, or you know, the logic of how the research is financed and so on. So what is really the problem in being received by the standard economics approach or standard department or standard journals in economics?
Well, thank you very much for this question. I think you mentioned already quite a lot of very important reasons. And I think, you know, the corporate concerns could be one of them. The issue with funding probably also. It's very peculiar, you know, how slow the academic community has been to acknowledge these contributions. And let me give you one little example and let my colleagues not be offended. I attended a conference of the Institute for New Economic Thinking in Paris recently, and there was a session on macroeconomic externalities. And I was quite perplexed and you know, astonished by the fact that there was no discussion of any environmental externalities. And you know, my good colleague Robert Ayres was the one who was seriously sort of responsible for introducing this topic at the macro scale back in 1968. So when a major conference in new economic thinking is announced, and the session is called macroeconomic externalities, and there is no discussion of, you know, anything related to biodiversity, water, climate change, or, you know, waste, or any of these issues, I somehow feel a little bit astonished that, you know, this seems to be the core. You know, this seems to be the area where a lot of funding should go. This seems to be the area where a lot of attention should be focused on how to put it right, you know, my experience in Bogota has been very diverse, and I've seen amazing museums and a beautiful botanical garden, but I also noticed a substantial amount of pollution. And we talked with my students about this quite a bit yesterday, for example, and we found out that in some areas of Bogota, the pollution of PM, the particulate matter, is higher than Shanghai, which is the absolute leader among the very large, you know, mega cities, including New York, London, Rio de Janeiro, and others. So there are substantial issues to be addressed in many different countries around the world, and I think the sooner we get to that, the better, because you know, look at what's happening. It's really astonishing. There's a wonderful quote by Einstein, who said something about the bees, the pollinators. You know, there are incredible problems with pollinators around the world. And there is a documentary which quotes the fact that the businesses have to ship bees on trucks from Florida to California to pollinate the plants. And the Einstein's quote was that if you lose the bees, you have only 3 or 4 years left, roughly speaking.
Wow. So I mean, give us some example. Probably it's easier for people to understand. I mean, you're a super expert, so you have been giving lecturing and giving conferences and seminars all around the world. I mean, you travel a lot, so I guess you face any kind of audience, from the most academic to the most general. And so what kind of critique do you normally receive in your approach, and in particular what kind of critique do you normally receive from resisting standard economic approach, let's say?
Well, I have to say that I tend to choose the audiences which could be, you know, more sympathetic. But one of the fundamental critiques, which I think has a lot of value, of ecological economics, was that there is no single integrated model that could be, you know, used and applied and, you know, cross-checked and you know, used for policy of the similar kind as, let's say, I don't know, the ISLM model, or, you know, the general equilibrium models that are currently being used in central banks and government departments. By the way, ecological economists were very heavily critical of the computable general equilibrium models for a variety of reasons. So I guess, you know, that's credible, but we're working on this, you know, so we're trying to make important steps. And, you know, a model like that would inherently be capable of taking notice of the intersectoral interactions, resource flows and emissions, important elements related to renewable energy and recycling sectors, would include the international linkages of trade in the global economy, and would also be dynamic in the sense that, you know, the future states will be related to past plus the management intervention and some, you know, random areas. And what's most important, it would be embedded in the wider natural science model. So
if you want to suggest to students, like, important questions or areas of research where they can approach ecological economics, what kind of suggestion would you give them?
Well, I would probably suggest to focus on the most topical issues, and for Colombia, I guess, you know, this would be ecosystems and biodiversity, but also climatic change, also waste. Specifically from ecological economics, I would suggest to be very clear on the use of certain tools and methods. And there is quite a lot that ecological economics could offer. For instance, it's a nice coincidence that in the end of August we'll have a summer school at Balliol College in Oxford, the Oxford Summer School in Ecological Economics, which is going to be taught by the leading ecological economists from all around the world, including Norway and Sweden and so forth. And this is going to be an amazing opportunity to interact with these people and also get a more, you know, solid understanding of ecological economic issues and methodologies.
Where can students find information, or about students or interest people, and where they can find information about this summer school in August?
The easiest way is to type environmenteurope.org in Google, and on the first page there is a big green button saying apply for the summer school.
Perfect. So you mentioned a book that you edited in 2012. It was published by Palgrave?
There are two books, in fact, you know. Yes.
Okay, so let's present this book. I mean, are they test books, or are they for a general public, for students, for PhD students, or?
Well, Sustainability Analysis, an Interdisciplinary Approach, an edited volume which was published by Palgrave, in fact was a follow-up from the international conference which we organized in St. Petersburg back in 2005. And it was a very nice conference, a very innovative, which was supposed to be, bridging different scientific communities and so on. It was attended by, I think, approximately 160 people from about 28 countries or so. So with some delay, we decided to gather the most important contributions, and they came from different countries, from Norway and Sweden and Russia and Canada and England and so forth. And we put it together in a book to show in which direction have our thoughts and thinking and projects progressed since 2005. So that was the main idea of this book. And it's available on Amazon, it's available on Palgrave website, Sustainability Analysis, an Interdisciplinary Approach. It's a good collection, and it's probably going to be very useful for anyone at the master's level and above who wants to get a more thorough understanding of current thinking.
Okay, let's move to the policy issues. You work for project related with various policy applications or your ideas or ideas in ecological economics. One of the main topic is certainly the one about sustainable city. So are there kind of big practice or main lessons that we can somehow draw from your approach, or that should be taken into account in the future planning of cities?
Well, one of the chapters of the second book, which was published in 2012, which is called Ecological Economics, Sustainability in Practice, published by Springer, is devoted to sustainable cities. And there is a methodological approach which is presented there, which is essentially focused on finding those interdisciplinary feedback loops that could help us understand how the cities could operate better. So, and these feedback loops are connecting such important aspects as sustainable transport and energy, preservation of natural cultural heritage, the issues of governance and democracy, water management and so forth. We have presented a comparative analysis. This chapter was written together with my very good colleague from St. Petersburg. This chapter was essentially comparing two large mega cities, if you like, London and St. Petersburg. More recently, I've developed a paper which is now under review, which is comparing a whole range of mega cities, including Los Angeles, New York, London, Paris, Berlin, Rio de Janeiro, Singapore, Hong Kong, and so on. On a whole range of sustainability indicators. And the surprising result was that overall we could say that the example of Singapore is extremely interesting for learning from best practices and transferring this knowledge around the world. We also identified some particular areas where more attention should be focused, these include recycling issues in Rio de Janeiro, for instance. Now we know that the public transport system in Bogota might need also some attention, I would say it's a first step. The experience that we've gathered allows us to compare and cross check and make some recommendations. But one of the most curious linkages that I was able to discover in the course of this work was a very amusing positive correlation between the number of film screenings in a city and reduced emissions of PM and CO2. The same applies to the larger number of galleries, art galleries, and reduced emissions of PM and CO2. There must be something there.
Okay. Do you have a kind of theory for this?
Well, I think art is one of these amazing things that could really transmit a good message and save the world. And probably if you drive less and watch less TV and walk more and go to galleries and film screenings, this means that your CO2 footprint is going to be much smaller. These emissions are going to be shared with a lot of other people. So it might be that those types of traditional occupations, such as playing wooden music and instruments, and painting and doing all kinds of theatrical activities, might be that kind of lifestyle, more sustainable lifestyle, which is associated with lower environmental impacts.
Okay. I was just curious, you mentioned Singapore as a special example to learn some best practice. Can you give a few examples of best practice from Singapore or peculiar thing that were successful in the way in which Singapore was planning its sustainability?
Well, I guess a lot can be explained by the sustainability strategy that was adopted, a very comprehensive and very detailed document which brought together various departments. And Singapore is a city and a country at the same time. So all the issues are decided by the ministries, which are at the same time, you know, committees responsible for the operation of the city of Singapore. The very crucial element that comes up every now and then in sustainability assessments for countries, and I guess it would be also applicable here, is the degree of interaction between various departments and the degree of creative collaboration. And this is illustrated by the example of Germany, for instance, where sustainability issues have been addressed really at a very high level. And I think this would be applicable to Singapore also.
Okay. Well, you have been traveling a little bit around Bogota. I mean, of course, it's the first time, so I cannot ask you in detail things about Bogota. But I was kind of wanted to ask you a more general question, because cities like Bogota, but other cities in South America are similar, are very chaotic, but also very contradictory, in the sense that I'm in the center of the city. Here you can find a very huge kind of park, for example, and there are various zones in the city where like 70% is rural still, no? And actually there is one of the zone of the city which is a huge water source, so basically, I mean, you're still in the city, but it seems really countryside. And on transport, I mean, Transmilenio, which is this kind of system of transport, was the second most successful experience of transport in Latin America. But at the same time, the level of pollution is disgustingly high. There are a lot of problems of mobility. So do you think there is some suggestion that some road that these cities should follow, alternative to what has been done in OECD countries, for example? Yeah. And secondly, I mean, here there is a huge debate about the use of the bicycle. So, you know, typically the debate is from people saying, I mean, this is just utopic, so you won't get any result on an environmental issue in any case. And other people, they say, no, I mean, we try to change behavior, at least we make like some recent most sensible the topic. So what do you think about these kind of strategies to promote sustainability in big cities?
We did a calculation with our students yesterday, and they were absolutely astonished. We found out that, roughly speaking, this is a very positive scenario, each person in Bogota City would need about 16 trees, very large, substantial trees, to be able to process the emissions from both human respiration and also the cars. All types of cars that are there in the city. At the moment, for each person, there is 0.16, so roughly 100 times less, which was a very educational experience for them, and they were shocked and perplexed, and they started asking, how we could approach this issue. And this is just CO2, it's not about even, all these dangerous substances which could damage people's health. Well, I would suggest to look at the European experience, at the experience of such large cities as Paris and Berlin, perhaps, and Vienna, which developed extremely successful public transport systems. Of course, it's an ethical issue. It's an issue of choice of the majority of population. But there are amazing examples. Paris, for example, has a very diverse, multi-layered system with high-speed regional trains which cross the city in all sorts of directions, the underground system, the buses and so forth, which really make sure that people, when thinking about how to go about their travels, decide to walk and use public transport instead of getting in their car and using other types of transportation. I think, you know, it's very complex. It's a lifestyle issue also. One has to make it fashionable and you know, popular and cool, and you know, walking is cool. I live here very close to the 7th Street, which seems to be a main avenue, but hardly anyone walks in the evenings. Hardly anyone walks. Everybody prefers to drive or take a taxi. And I think, you know, your example of bicycles is also, you know, could be very relevant. On Sundays, I noticed that, you know, a lot of people are cycling. But with all honesty, you really need a very sophisticated system of dedicated bicycle lanes, because you don't want any accidents. It has to be very separated also. And at the same time, you want to address the pollution issues also, because in some parts, cycling might be dangerous for people's health at the moment.
Yeah, actually, I wanted to ask about, is there a kind of development approach to ecological economics? Because you mentioned the issues of bicycle, for example. I don't know if you knew, but Bogota is actually the city that has a larger number of kilometers of bicycle lane. But what you get is precisely that in many zones of the city, of course, it's very dangerous to go for security reason. And since here the informal economy is so huge, so there is one of the main avenue, for example, where essentially all the bicycle lane is covered by people which is selling things. So the bicycle should go essentially on the street, because you know, what is left is basically used by people walking. So it's very difficult there. So is there someone in ecological economics which try to address the kind of peculiar problems that emerge related with the environment in, you know, developing countries or middle-income countries?
Well, traditionally there has been quite a lot of discussion of the north-south divide, and, you know, resource use issues and international trade related issues, which put the countries of the south in a very peculiar and special position. And I guess, you know, with the development of statistical base, now we will have a lot more opportunities to do that, because there are now very substantial databases which include flows of international trades of many goods, input output tables for many countries, and one could really start looking at these issues in quite a lot of detail. One of my Australian colleagues has developed an approach which was able to show the extent to which biodiversity in Malaysia is destroyed by consumption activities in different countries of the world, and reversely, how consumption in one country like Germany is somehow responsible for affecting biodiversity in other countries around the world. And I think, you know, these are very welcome contributions, and as time goes by, there will be more and more of them, and they'll be more integrated into a holistic approach.
Okay. So unfortunately, we have to close. Thank you very much for the interview. I just want to mention that, of course, on Amazon or in general, on various online library, you can find the two books that were mentioned before. We mentioned also the summer school in August and the way to find information. I just closed by mentioning that beside your webpage, that of course can be available on Google, Professor Shmalev is also an important artist and photographer, so he has done many exhibition around the world, so I suggest also people to look for his artistic work as a complement to art numbers, let's say. So thank you very much for the interview.
Many thanks.